Dear brothers and sisters, let us quiet our hearts as we prepare to worship God in this morning act of worship. We begin our service as we sing hymn 298, "Oh, for a heart to praise my God." Continue this morning's worship as we follow the call to worship. When you withdraw their breath, they died and returned to their dust. When you send forth your spirit, they created and you renew the face of the earth. God sent the Holy Spirit to the disciples with a sound from heaven and in tongues of flame. Send us out in the power of the same Spirit to witness to your truth and to draw all peoples to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us worship God in spirit and in truth. Amen. Thanks be to God. Together, Almighty God, in the time of great need, you raised up your servants, John and Charles Wesley, and by the Spirit inspired them to kindle a flame of sacred love, which leaped and ran an inextinguishable blaze. Grant that all those whose hearts have been warmed at these altar fires, being continually refreshed by your grace, may be so devoted to the increase of scriptural holiness throughout the land that in this our time of great need, your will may full and effectively be done on earth as it is in heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, a charge to keep we have, and therefore we sing hymn 314, a charge to keep I have, a God to glorify. A charge to keep we have, and a big God to glorify. Let us pray. Almighty God, you are author of life. We are in awe of your creation. The vast oceans reflect your majesty. The ever-changing skies renew our lands. The deep valleys carry your peace and shelter. You are Savior of the world. We are amazed at your grace. The nations find peace in your forgiveness. The sufferer hope in your healing hands. The burdened rest in your promise of heaven. You are unconditional love. We are privileged to be filled by your presence. The youth are filled with your vision. The old are filled with your wisdom. The oppressed, unchained by your freedom. Therefore, Almighty God, Father and Son and Spirit, we worship you. Let us pray our prayer of confession. And your response is, Lord, have mercy. Forgive our foolish or careless way use of the gifts of your creation. Lord, have mercy. For our indifference to the needs of others, our brothers and sisters for whom you died, Christ, have mercy. For our neglect of fellowship and the means of grace in worship and private prayer, Lord, have mercy. God proves his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. Thanks be to God. Let us go to God in assurance of pardon. Who is a pardoning God like you? Who else have grace so rich and so free? Almighty God, we come to your fountain of pardon, believing that you do not keep a record of our wrongs, and having confessed our sins, you will faithfully forgive us and purge us from all unrighteousness. People of God, it is done. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God. We continue as we sing hymn 248, Ye Servants of God, as we prepare for our prayer of thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we humbly thank you for your goodness to us and to all that you have made. We praise you for your creation, for keeping us and all things in your care, and for all the blessings of life. Above all, we bless you for your immeasurable love, in redeeming the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray that you give us such an awesomeness of your mercies that with thankful hearts we praise you not only with our lips but in our lives. By giving ourselves to your service, and by living in your gifts of holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all worship and praise now and forevermore. Amen. We continue as we sing hymn 254, Love Divine or Love's Excelling.
Ourselves for the ministry of the word that is joined together in saying the collect appointed for today. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. We beseech you, leave us not comfortless, but send your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to the place where our Savior Christ is gone before, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our epistle reading comes from the book of Acts, chapter 1, reading verses 6 to 14. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by. They said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. My brothers and sisters, this is the word of the Lord.
Let us stand for the reading of the gospel taken from John chapter 17, verses 1 to 11. Glory to you, O God. Jesus had spoken these words. He looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may be glorified in you. Since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I have in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I come from you, and they have believed that you have sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. I have been glorified in them, and now I'm no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. Brothers and sisters, the gospel of Christ. Please sit at this time in preparation for our sermon. We are going to listen to a solo by Sister Dolores Samuel. But before we listen, I would like to remind you, as we prepare to hear the sermon, that you place your hand, take out your wallet, and give as we listen to the word of God. Sister Dolores Samuel.
Thank you. Peace in the name of Jesus the Christ. Thank you for joining our worship, and we want to thank all of you. We thank God for life. We thank God by his grace and mercies. Even in the midst of all these trials and challenges, God has been so gracious to us. So today we give thanks and praise to him. So let us bow our heads as we go to God in prayer. Our eternal God, this present day, Lord, we come before you. We give you thanks and praise for all your goodness and mercies upon our lives. We thank you, God, for many blessings you have bestowed upon our lives. We thank you for good health. We thank you for the food that you provide for us. We thank you for family, friends, our loved ones. We thank you, God, for our nation, St. Lucia. We thank you for everyone in our nation. And we thank you, God, even for the fact that you are bringing our economy back to life. We thank you, God, for all your mercies upon our lives. This present day, Lord, we commit our act of worship in your hands. Father, we ask, O God, even as we are in your presence from our various homes, we invoke, O God, your blessings upon everyone who is listening to my voice, those who are going through trial times, those who are in difficult situation. Father, I pray that, Lord, you touch them, O God, and bring deliverance to your people. Those who are sick in hospitals, those who are struggling for their lives, Father, we ask you to renew their strength, even as your word is coming to us, O God. We pray that you open our hearts, our minds, that your word will find, O God, root in our hearts, so that we continue to deepen our relationship with you. So, gracious Lord, we are in your hands. Even as I stand before your people, O God, I humble myself, O God. Talk to me so that I will be able to talk to your people. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our heart be pleasing unto you, O God. Have your own way and let your perfect will be done in our lives. We thank you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. My brothers and sisters, last Thursday, we celebrated Ascension Day, the day when Jesus left his disciples here on earth and returned to heaven with God. It is called Ascension because literally, Jesus ascended to heaven or rose into the air and disappeared from the sight of his disciples, as recorded in our epistle reading, Acts chapter 1, verses 9 to 11. It says, when he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a crowd took him out of their sight. While he was going, they were gazing up towards heaven. Suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. So this marks the end of Jesus' own ministry here on earth. It marks the beginning of that ministry that he left for all of us in our relationship with God. My brothers and sisters, as people called Methodists, today is a special day for us. As people called Methodists, we commemorate a pivotal event in the life of John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement. So for the Methodists, today refers to as Aldersgate Sunday or Heritage Sunday. Aldersgate meeting was an experience of God's grace that began John Wesley's transformation from an ineffective Anglican clergyman into one of the most effective and influential leaders in the Christian history. The question confronts us today is, what is so special about Aldersgate Day that we celebrate every year as Methodists? That is the big question we need to ask. So here we see a man, John Wesley, who had been washed in the Holy Spirit. So the question is, have you also been washed in the Holy Spirit as a Methodist? John Wesley, as a son of the manse, as people used to call, that is the minister's son, he had infant baptism. He was brought up in the Christian home, but that was not enough. He prayed regularly, and history tells us that John Wesley would pray for 3 hours a day. That was not enough to make him a Christian. He studied his Bible. He entered into holy orders. He founded a reforming movement. He engaged in good works and used all the means of grace at his disposal. He had this rich experience from home. My brothers and sisters, you can do all the good, but without the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life,
your life is still empty. You can go about doing good, preaching the gospel, doing everything, but if the Holy Spirit is not in your life is empty without the Spirit of God. So upon all this rich background of John Wesley, he was lacking one thing. Before these others get experience, John Wesley has sought assurance of his sins forgiven, but he was unable to obtain it through his many pious or good works. That is why I'm saying that your good work alone cannot save you. We are saved only by the grace of God. Our good works. Because John Wesley thought he was doing good work. So before the others get experience, Wesley lacked a personal assurance of the forgiving love of God for himself. In Wesley's pre-Aldersgate journey, we see much of his father's rigidity in his life. You recall, the father was an Anglican priest, so that had influence on John Wesley's ministry. He was so rigid because he thought only works could save him. His father's religion was a burden to him, not a blessing to his parishioners. It was a religion under the law and not in response to the grace of God. My brothers and sisters, so after that strangely heartwarming experience of John Wesley, he had found peace of mind at last. So May 24th, 1738 marked an important theological as well as psychological turning point in John Wesley's life. After this encounter, he made very profound statement, "The whole world is my parish," meaning taking the whole gospel to the whole people in the whole world. In other words, the whole world became his mission field. My brothers and sisters, when we are encountered with the Holy Spirit, the whole world becomes our mission field. We cannot see it when the Holy Spirit is at work in us. So today, as we observe Aldersgate, or our Heritage Day, as people called Methodists, it is not only marks the spiritual experience of John Wesley and Charles Wesley and others, but it calls us to worship the God who is still strangely warms the hearts of all who place their trust in Christ alone as their Lord and their Savior. My brothers and sisters, this experience points to us that, like John Wesley and Charles Wesley, it is only grace through faith which we may know that our sins are forgiven. Brothers and sisters, today, as we reflect on the work that God used Wesley and others to accomplish for their generation, the question is, what are we also doing today? What is our heart strangely warming experience today? What are we doing to build on the foundation, that's the legacy that our forebears, they left for us? What are we also doing? My brothers and sisters, as we celebrate today, the Holy Spirit who warmed John Wesley and others' heart, I want to draw your attention to our text from John chapter 17, verse 11. John chapter 17, verse 11, and it reads, "And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world. And I'm coming to you, Holy Father. Protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." So our theme for meditation is a time of great insecurity. We are secure in Christ. In a time of great insecurity, as people of God, we are secure in Christ. John and Charles Wesley, they faced a mountain of challenges. They felt insecure
as they were as we are experiencing today in our day. But they were secured in Christ because they have come to believe and wash by the Holy Spirit. They allow the Holy Spirit to wash them. And therefore they were able to stand against all the trials that confronted them. This time of insecurity, my brothers and sisters, we are secured in Christ. In fact, we are protected by God's name. We are going to make it out of this crisis because Jesus is praying for us. Jesus is praying for us in our crisis. He wants you and I to be secured. In fact, our security is paramount to Jesus. So in our text, we see Jesus praying for the disciples and all of us. And as you know, today, we live in an unsettled world where people long to find their way and to feel secure. We are in a world where money rules and greedy system call the tune and everything else falls. We are in the world where many people are experiencing poverty, where people are experiencing pain, injustice at the hand of the so-called well-to-do people in the society, where many are so anxious, where people don't even know what tomorrow holds for them. So it is in this context that Jesus prayed for the disciples. So in John 17:11, we hear Jesus praying to God on behalf of the disciples. Jesus is taken up by God, as we notice in our epistle reading in the book of Acts. He is no longer physically present with the disciples. Before Jesus leaves, we find him praying for the disciples and those who were to follow after the disciples. So in verse 1 of John chapter 17, Jesus declared, "Father, the hour has come. Father, the hour has come." So the question is, what is the meaning of "Father, the hour has come"? The hour has come suggests to me, or it points to the appointment of the cross, what Jesus was to establish on the cross. A time of separation, a time of betrayal, a time of suffering and crucifixion. Father, the hour has come. It was a time in which God's eternal purpose is about to be carried out. A time in which Jesus is about to bear his sins of the world on the cross. My brothers and sisters, as you listen to this prayer of Jesus, you hear the prayer of a man who endures great stress. He knows what is coming. He knows that the next 24 hours will hold shame, will hold torture and death. Jesus knew his followers were about to face difficulties. Difficulty of feeling lonely, difficulty of insecurity, scared, uncertain, violence, difficulty of feeling deserted, feeling alone, feeling abandoned, unloved, hopeless, or futureless. My brothers and sisters, so in verse 11, Jesus prayed, "Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are." Jesus will no longer remain in the world, but his disciples will be in the world as we are in the world. And the word "world" in the New Testament thought could mean one of three things. The first one is that it could mean this planet we called Earth. The second one is the world of humanity or people. And the third, it could mean the world as a principle in an ethical sense. So Jesus is saying that his disciples will live on the earth around people, but they are to be protected from the world values, the morals, the standards, the ideas and principles that are opposed to God. My brothers and sisters, this is what John Wesley and Charles Wesley stood for. After their encounter with the Holy Spirit, that strange woman experience, they were transformed by the Holy Spirit and they transformed the world around them. So when you catch the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit is at work in you, you transform your life by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that also transforms the world around you. My brothers and sisters, this world is so scary. It's a scary place because so many things are happening. This world is different from God. In this world, the disciples could expect hatred from the world. The values of the world, the distress and desires of the world, aspirations of the world stood in sharp contrast and direct conflict with God himself. For these disciples to be able to make an impact and transform the world, our text is Jesus pray for them. And Jesus is praying for us as well. So in our text, there are three areas that we notice that Jesus prays for us. The first one is that he prays for our protection in this world, because Jesus knew there are so many challenges in the world. And therefore he prayed for protection for us. He prays for security. He called on God to protect you and I. He points us to the fact that our protector is God. So he says, Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me. So to be protected by the name of God is to be protected by the one who is sovereign, one who is holy, all-knowing, all-wise, compassionate God, ever-present and all-powerful. So Jesus says, protect them in your name. So the disciples were protected by the powerful name, just as we are. Just as John Wesley, Charles Wesley, they were protected by a powerful name. So in spite of all the confrontation, in spite of all the challenges, because they were protected by a powerful name, they were able to make it. And we will make it because we have been protected by a powerful name. My brothers and sisters, we are secured. We are protected. The same way that God protected John and Charles to fulfill their mission. So you could see that the followers of Jesus are protected by the Father's authority. Jesus asks that we be protected from evil. Protection that God alone can provide. Jesus is saying to us that our protection comes from our Heavenly Father, God himself. Guardianship comes from the Father. He is our divine parent. My brothers and sisters, I want to assure all of us today that our protection is guaranteed even in the midst of this crisis. We and our families are kept safe. It does not mean that we are trouble-free. It does not mean that we are pain free. It does not mean that we are suffering free. It does not mean that we are harsh free. The simple answer is that we are secured in Christ. And we have been protected by a powerful name. We are secured. So the point I'm making this morning is only God can protect us from this crisis. Yes, we need a vaccine. That is good. We need social distancing. That is good. We need frequent washing of our hands. That is good. Wearing of face masks is good. But only God can protect us by that powerful name. We can have all these things, but it is only God and God alone who can protect us. Today, let us be rest assured that God is in charge. God knows what God is doing. Only God can protect us. Only God can make us holy. Jesus asked God to do for us what only God can do. My brothers and sisters, he asked God to protect us from malicious powers, powers of sickness, powers of pain, powers of rejection, powers of jealousy, powers of death, powers of domineering spirit. Jesus prayed that God will protect us from those powers. So we are secured. So why are you afraid? Jesus has prayed for you, and Jesus is praying for you. My brothers and sisters, today, Jesus wants us to know that the answer to our life is not within us. It is within God. The answer to our church's future, as to whether to open or not to open, is not within us, but it is within God. It is not within our own inclinations, not in our own pride, or our own ideas and programs, but within God and God alone. The healing so desperately needed for this broken world as a result of this COVID-19 crisis will not come from the so-called great nations or from our strong financial institution. It will come from God and God alone. It will come from God. So today we know our intercessor. We know our advocate. We know our defender. He desire that we who are redeemed stay safe. He is asking God to keep you and I in his name. The second thing that Jesus prays for us is our unity. So if you look at verse 11 again, he says, Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. So Jesus prayed that the disciples, his followers, we will be one, united. We need protection to maintain our unity in the face of everything the world throws at us to divide us. We need unity. And the source of our unity is not in human structures or denominations. It is in Jesus. Our unity is in Jesus. Our unity gives us strength in difficult times. So God expects us, these difficult times, we need to be united in order to be protected and strengthened. So my brothers and sisters, Jesus knew that the enemy was out there, ready to cause dissension, to cause strife and hatred among God's people, to cause dissension among the nation, whether yellow or white or blue or green or what color. That is the work of the devil, to divide us. So Jesus realized that he need to pray for the disciples so that they will be one. Jesus is praying that the divisions that often separate us, race and background, education, attainment, or business success, social position, financial security, or lack of these may not separate us. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, but we are all one in Christ. Our true identity is one of community, equality, justice, and love. This is what the Spirit of God inspired John Wesley and Charles Wesley to do in their time to transform their world. So my brothers and sisters, that is the hallmark of every Methodist. That we, the Methodists, our heritage is justice. Our heritage is equality. Our heritage is community living and love. So Jesus prays for the unity of his disciples, for oneness in spirit, so that they keep the revelation of the one true God of love and peace. Today, instead of being one, we find ourselves separated. We have built fences and walls around us. There are fences based on physical appearances, separating persons of different race or ethnicity or gender. There are fences based on nationality, regions, or language, or even accent. Even in worship service, sometimes we disagree over the length of the service. What kind of hymns or instrument is acceptable in the house of God? What prayers should be included? Who should or should not do certain parts of the service? How people should dress, and much more, is happening even in the house of God. Division, a maze of disagreement and confusion, we find the founder of the church praying for us. He prays for unity, for peace and love among the people of God. My brothers and sisters, protection comes in unity with other believers. We were never intended to fight the battle alone. They needed, indeed, strength in numbers. We are to fight as a unit, a battalion of believers. Stay close with one another. Stay protected by staying in contact with one another. Let us remember, unity exists through prayer. Jesus prayed for unity, and the disciples prayed together to draw upon the only source of power that they had before received the Holy Spirit in the upper room. And finally, my brothers and sisters, Jesus also prayed for eternal life for us. Apart from praying for protection, apart from praying that we will walk in unity, Jesus again prayed for eternal life for us. So if you look at verses 2 and 3, it reads, "Since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, and the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent." So Jesus prayed that the disciples will have eternal life, that we will have eternal life. And if we look at the word eternal life, it's translated to mean fullest, completion, abundant, filled up. So eternal life is abundant life, a full life, a life which lived in completion, a life of wholeness, exactly the way it is supposed to be or meant to be. So Jesus prays that we will have a full life, a fulfilled life, a meaningful life. Eternal life is a way of living life here on earth, full, rich, and free. This is life found in relationship with the God. Eternal life is when we choose to live in relationship with Jesus Christ, with the Father, and with God. We are chosen, or we are choosing to also be in relationship with all those who are loved by God and loved by Jesus Christ. My brothers and sisters, as I conclude, be reminded that in a time of great insecurity, we are secure in Christ because Jesus prays for our protection. He prays for our security. He called on God to protect you and I. He prays for our unity because unity lies strength. He prays for our eternal life to be with God. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us bow heads as we go to God in prayer. And so, Lord, we are so thankful to you for your word that has come to assure us that even in the midst of all our trials, the challenges that confront us, we have intercessor. We are being secured. We are being protected by a powerful name. The name that protected John Wesley and Charles Wesley, the same name is protecting us. And we want to thank you for this assurance. I pray, oh God, that Lord continue to guide us in these troubled waters. Continue to lead us, oh God. When we are weak, continue to strengthen us. Let your presence always be with us, oh God. And let your peace that passes all human understanding, may this peace continue to stay and abide with us. We thank you, oh God, for your love, for your keeping. We thank you, God, for this assurance that even in the midst of our crisis, we are secure in you. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Brothers and sisters, we have all heard that there is hope and we need that protection from our God. As we prepare to go into our prayers of intercession, we are going to prayerfully sing, Spirit Divine, attend our prayers, hymn 157. And if you want to kneel, you can kneel while you sing. If you just want to sit, you can sit or stand. Spirit Divine, attend our prayer.
So let this be our congregational prayer.
Thank you.
My brothers and sisters, we now intercede on behalf of our colleagues, our friends, friends of Methodism, friends in our communities. And we begin by sharing prayer requests from Sister Casbury for all students writing online examinations. We have a prayer request from Sister Marlene Richards, Barbados, and her request for prayers is for her families in Barbados and St. Vincent. Our brother Ben Gittins of Grenada requests prayers and God's grace. Sister Carol Taylor asks for prayers so she can sleep better at nights. And Stephanie Clark of Barbados requests a prayer for her children, Wayne Clark and Anthony Clark. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, we ask you this morning to look in mercy upon all those with special needs, upon all those who have submitted a prayer request, and upon those who have needs but did not submit a request. We ask you to give strength to the weary. We ask you to give new courage to those who are losing heart. And we ask you to give hope to those in despair, that they may see again new opportunities to live for you. We ask, O Lord, that you give health to the sick. We ask, Lord, that you give liberty to the captives, and that you give a sense of security to the anxious, that they may live in confidence. We ask, O Lord, that you give to all your people the grace of the Holy Spirit, the knowledge of the forgiveness of their sins, and the assurance of salvation through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Your response to our intercessory prayers is here our prayer. My brothers and sisters, on this Sunday morning, for remembering our heritage as people called Methodists, we connect to the core beliefs that have shaped our unique place among God's people as we lift up prayers for those in need, both in the church and the world. Lord, have mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As people called Methodists, we are rooted in the tradition of God's love, seeking to warm, inspire, and ignite human hearts, individually and in community, so that those to whom love is a stranger will find in us godly, outreaching, and caring friends. God reawakened this mission in and through us, especially this time of crisis. Lord, in your mercy, as God's children, we are rooted in the tradition of God's grace and love harmonizing with the whole of creation. God, inspire us to be good stewards of the nature around us, honoring the message of a new life as we see in it. Lord, in your mercy. As people of God, we are rooted in a tradition of faith to be experienced, not only believe in right thinking, but felt deeply in hearts and souls, and thus lived in practical discipleship. God, show us how to live, love, and serve others, not only with our lips, but with our whole lives. Lord, in your mercy. As Methodists, we are rooted in the tradition of compassion for the least, the lowly, and all who suffer. God, use us individually and in community to bring healing and hope to the disease of our hearts, souls, and minds. Enliven us as agents of relief and wholeness to all who suffer. Lord, in your mercy, As people called Methodists, we are rooted in a tradition of spreading spiritual holiness. God, move us beyond mere biblical literalism and narrowness to be inspired by Bible living word, calling people to lives transformed by your unconditional love. Lord, in your mercy, as people, we are rooted in the tradition of passionate prayer for one another. Let us now pray for the needs and concerns on our hearts and in our minds. Into your care, O God, we place ourselves and all our prayers, trusting your promise of new life in Jesus Christ. Forgive our sins and hear the other biddings we bring. Fulfill our requests and desires, not as we ask in ignorance, nor as we think we deserve, but as you know and love us in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Together we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And as usual, the church joins in congratulating those who are celebrating their birthdays, who may have celebrated last week, celebrating today, and celebrating the week to come. We start with Michaela Kazemi, who will be celebrating on the 24th of May. We have Elsa Miller, celebrating on the 26th of May. Beverly Thomas will celebrate a birthday on the 29th of May. Zaki Abotini on the 30th of May. Tyra Kodra and Jason Kodra, belated birthday greetings from Alvin Kodra, and they would have celebrated on the 22nd of May. Sister Eldora celebrating birthday on the 30th of May. Commander Otley, 24th of May. Biddy Otley, 27th of May. And we have Sister Nicole Edgecombe, who extends birthday wishes to her mom and her brother-in-law, both celebrating today. And as a church, we wish them happy birthday as we sing, "Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you." The anniversaries, we have Christine Marshall and Perry Marshall celebrating the third wedding anniversary on Wednesday. And we have Sister Nicole Edgecombe wishing her sister and brother-in-law happy anniversary. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless and keep you. May the good Lord bless you. Let's pray, brothers and sisters. We give thanks to God this morning for the birthday celebrations of our brothers and our sisters in Christ. Today we ask God to continue to bless you, every one of you, with every kind of joy on your birthday, and that you would enjoy many more years to come. We pray that God shower you with his grace, his guidance, his direction, his protection as you celebrate your birthday and every day hereafter. May you be comforted by his presence in your life and always follow his guiding light. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Before we bring our service to a close, I just want to remind you that on June the 7th, all our congregations will be reopened. That day, June the 7th, is also coming on Sunday. I remind you also that our circuit office on Chisel Street is open for business from Monday to Friday between the hours of 10 to 12 in the morning. Also wish to remind you of our radio and TV programs entitled A Life Changing God, NBC TV at 6:30 p.m. and Real FM 7:15 every Sunday. With the hope of resurrection, we announce the passing into glory of our sister Ruby Dean. A further arrangements will be communicated later. We ask that you kindly lift her and her family up in prayer. Amen. So let us bring our service to a close this morning as we sing our hymn 188 in the voice in praise, the Methodist anthem, And Can It Be?
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, let me express sincere thanks to all of you, especially Reverend Anne, who conducted the service, and also our technicians. We want to thank you, Brother Tim, Jamal, James, Brother Prosper, Arvin Kodra, Mr. Small, and all of us here. We want to thank all of you. And also, of course, you, our listeners and viewers, we appreciate your involvement and your feedbacks. So we want to thank all of you, and we ask God's blessings upon all of us. Let us bow our heads as we pronounce the benediction. And so, Lord, we thank you for the end of our worship, which is the beginning of our worship to you, O God. As we go back to our various places, we commit our homes, we pray at our workplaces, that, Lord, your protection that you have promised, that Jesus is praying for us, will continue to be secured in you. That wherever we find ourselves, will be a uniting factor by bringing unity, like John and Charles Wesley trying to unite in the whole world. And also, Lord, we know that our eternal life has been secured. So we want to thank you, O God. So, Lord, continue to guide and protect and provide for all our needs. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his light of countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. May the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. Have a wonderful week. God bless us all. Thank you, and God bless us all. Have a wonderful week.